Thank you for tuning in to Hope TV, the television broadcast ministry of Hope Alive Freedom Church. We are real people offering real hope in a real world.
Here we go.
At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
And we're just honored, man. We're just so glad you guys are here. And so listen, everything we're doing today, our most sincere prayer for you today is that everything that we do today will create an opportunity for you to experience God and experience worship in a wonderful way, the most fabulous worship experience you've ever had in your entire life. Our honest aim, listen to me, congregation, you're gonna help me out with this thing, right? Is that you leave this place with a little more faith and a little more hope and a little more than what you walked in with, amen? Congregation, why don't you welcome our first time guest as well as our television audience this morning. So glad you're here. So listen, if this is your first time, maybe you've been around here a little while, been kind of spying on us, you know, checking us out and trying to figure out, hey man, do I really belong here? Or, you know, and if you want to know how to connect and how to grow with us, all you got to do is just take a moment, and I encourage you, everybody, take a moment, reach that backseat pocket that's right in front of you, and during the service, fill that thing out, and when it gets to my decision, just kind of wait, you know, because whether you're going to turn it in or not later, whatever, that's all good, but just take a moment, fill that thing out, and I'll give you some instructions as to what to do with that at the end, amen? Well, let me get the kids to come quickly, we're gonna bless you guys and dismiss you today. By the way, if you're going to the junior high service, you'll see Pastor Desmond. He's all the way in the back of the foyer. So you guys will exit the same place that the rest of the children's ministry will exit. But you don't have to come here for me to bless you because I don't want you to think like, well, hey, I'm not a kid. You know what I mean? Even though your parents probably think differently. So anyways, if you're in junior high, you'll meet Pastor Desmond when we dismiss. Well, congregation, why don't you stretch your faith toward these wonderful children. And let's bless them this morning. Father, we bless these guys, God, your children, God, loaned to us from heaven, that Father, today you would anoint their ears that they could hear your voice, and God, their eyes that they could see you and see your plan for their life and their future in you. And Father, would you anoint their hearts that they're hungry for it, that they grab it, their minds, God, that they can comprehend what is the perfect will of God for their life. So we ask that you keep them, God, you protect them, that you promote them, that you provide for them, as well as all of the children's pastors. Those guys are going to just be pouring into those kids today, and all the leaders in Jesus' name. And all God's people agree with that said, amen, amen, amen. Well, before you sit down, turn around, give somebody a high five, tell them welcome to the house. How many guys really appreciate all the children? Look at them go. Hey, so check this out. Let me give a little prop. Man, we got some hope heroes around here. And just this week, man, all the children were out at children's camp. And I just want to give a little honor where honor is due. Thank you so much. Don't we have a wonderful children's pastor and Pastor Nicole? Don't we? Come on, somebody. right? So, but they don't like know me like up close, and so they know the persona. They know how I dress. They know how I talk. They know what I do. They know the vehicle I drive. They know of my family. They see them interact, you know, stuff like that. But they don't really know me. But I've had some people that know me from a distance, from time to time, and say, "Man, dude, I wish that I had your life." Huh? Right. So I wish that I had your life. I mean, it just, everything seems so perfect, and it's all in order, and it's all together. I mean, your marriage is great, and you know, I mean, look at your children. I mean, they're all in school, and they make great grades, and you know, they're not in detention, you know, after school, stuff like that, and they're just great. You got a great wife, you got great kids, and they're all involved in ministry, and wow, you know, your finances are all in order, and you know, man, if I had a life like you, Pastor, then maybe I could serve God the way that you do. And so, but you know me from a distance. You know, so those that would tell me stuff like that, my first response, honestly, is number one, honestly, you don't really know me. and the truth would be, listen, please aim higher, because it ain't all that good. You know what I mean? I mean, it's great, and it's much better than what it's been, but I would say, man, shoot for the stars, right? I mean, aim for something a little better than maybe, you know what I mean, like me. And secondly, I would say, you know, honestly, you don't really know me, and if you really knew me, you'd know that I spend an awful lot of time on my knees begging God to do some great things for me. And if you really knew me, then you'd know that if there's any good thing in my life, right? So anything at all, I mean, my marriage, my family, or anything good, I will attribute that to a life of prayer. See, my marriage wasn't always in order. I mean, my life wasn't always in order. But what's brought it in order is this idea of prayer. Now, here's just the truth of where we're at, sort of, you know, as a church, and what I'm trying to get us to do is, you know, honestly, I just want to apologize and say, you know, I probably just haven't done such a great job over the past, you know, 5-6 years or so, really emphasizing the importance of prayer. And it's not that, listen, it's not that we don't value prayer around here. We do. I mean, we're constantly praying. Did you know, every Thursday night, a group of youth on their own, not under the direction of our youth pastors, they didn't say, listen, you guys need to start a prayer group or anything. I mean, on their own, young people, high school students, they gather together, and look, they come right here in church, and they pray the paint off the walls. You know what I mean? I mean, these guys are radical, and they're, wow, and it's like, it's awesome. Right? It's not that we don't pray. I mean, there's we have prayer groups. We have intercessory prayer groups that meet on Monday, and they pray for me. As a matter of fact, right now, right behind me on this stage, there are people praying, walking up and down these aisles, right behind this platform in the hallway behind me, and they're praying for you. They're praying that you would be able to see God, that all of those, maybe those distractions and stuff would be silenced, that, you know, those voices that are clamoring for your attention, all of those things would be silenced, that you would hear God's voice, and that God would do just a great and wonderful work in your life. It's not that we don't pray around here. We do pray, but the truth is, I'm saying, you know, I just think we could do better, right? I just think we could do better. And I can tell you, I mean, there was once a time in our ministry when our campus was located in Broussard, in the center of Broussard, Louisiana, just south of us right here. And there was a time we had a 24-hour prayer room. It was open 24 hours a day. We had a water fountain in there, like a well, and we had prayer stations all over, you know. And so if you didn't know what to pray, you got to go like, okay, so let me pray about this. What I do first? Okay, I'm going to pray right. And then, you know, all that. I used to have a log book for people to sign in, because I'd watch my leaders and make sure you're praying, you know. But then when we moved and we relocated our campus to South Lafayette, where we're at right now, when we did that, man, we went to work as a congregation. We spent thousands and thousands of hours every week. Not contractors. This was us. And we were working, we were doing the construction in the building, and we did that for almost a year in order to be in here. As a matter of fact, we got in like, when we were kicked out of the other property because our time was up on the contract, the first service was Easter service, and we had to have it outside because we didn't have permission to come in the building. The fire marshal didn't allow us. But we worked so hard, and before you knew it, we weren't thinking about that house of prayer or anything like that, and then before you knew it, we started talking about, okay, let's open up that house of prayer. Then we had like security issues, because in this location, we got, people that are trans, transients, and some will come and they'll squat on the back of the property, and they're homeless and they're looking for things, and some of them are just mentally, just mentally handicapped, or maybe just kind of bound by addictions and stuff like that. So they just find their way around here, and they squat around here. And so, for our female staff, it's not really comfortable to say, to have any female staff in here at night and be alone. They just don't feel real comfortable, and, neither do I. And likewise, when they come, we just didn't do that. Right, because at the old church, man, everybody had a code, man, and so everybody had a key to the prayer room. Everybody could get in, but here we couldn't do that because security issues and stuff like that. But here's my thought this morning. My thought this morning is, prayer is powerful, and it's important, right? I mean, it's a valuable tool that God gives us to connect with heaven. So what I want to do this morning is, in this little mini series, I just want to take the first step towards righting a misstep, right? Like, how can I correct us? Because God said that my house shall be known as a house of prayer, right? It should be known that way, right? So we're going to begin the first series today, the first message of a two-part series today, entitled Pray First. And my goal is that this would become the rally cry of our church. I mean, when we're going to war or we're seeking God for something, the first thing we do is pray first. Say it with me, pray first, right? So in every situation, right, in every circumstance, before every decision, we simply pray first. Can you imagine with me just for a moment, can you imagine with me how your life might look differently? Come on, man, I'm really visiting you right now. If you just prayed first, stay with me. Listen, when you start talking about prayer, this is like what Christians, they all get beat up, right? Because they all know they should be praying more. That's not the point of this message here. I'm trying to take you somewhere. Can you imagine with me just for a moment how your life might just be different if in everything, not just some things, but in everything, you just prayed first? And I'm not talking about nothing strange. I'm not talking about, Christians praying in screamo stereo. Jesus! I'm not talking like that. And listen, neither am I mocking that. I don't mean to be mocking that, because I'm really loud. And that's the trouble, right? Because if I model prayer, I'm loud, and people say, I can't do that. that's just not me. I'm not talking about anything strange about prayer or anything weird about prayer. I'm just simply saying, before you started your day, when you got out of bed, the first thing you did was say, good morning, Father. What if before you took off, before you ran out the door, you dashed out the door and got into this rat race called life, before you did that, maybe you sat with your Bible and a cup of coffee at the kitchen table or wherever that your quiet place is, and what if before you ran out that door, right, because you slept in too late, what if you just prayed first? I mean, my question is, how would your marriage be different, huh? I mean, how would your family be different? How would your children be different? How would your business be different? How would our church be different? I mean, how would our city be different if we just pray first? Can you say that with me? I need to get this thing. If we just pray, you're getting it. Can you imagine? Can you imagine with me? I mean, before the kids, before you take the kids to school or they run out the door, if you just precious this morning. Two children left my house this morning before I did. Now, I have a garage office. It's where I meet with God. I meet with God in my garage. As a matter of fact, there was a lawn chair that one of my friends in our congregation bought for me for Christmas two or three years ago for Christmas. And it was like a big chair, and it was strong, you know. And they bought it for me for Christmas. I thought, wow, this is a great chair. It's so comfortable. As a matter of fact, I sit in that chair so much in my office, my garage office where I meet with God, my prayer closet, right? I sit in it so much that I wore a hole through the material. And so, I put duct tape. It's got duct tape on the chair. I had to fix it the other day. I said, "No, man, this is where I meet with God. I can't do that." But today I was in my prayer closet, my prayer office, my office garage, meeting with the Lord. And two of my kids left. Victoria left earlier this morning. She's the president, a co-president of the Lafayette High Chorus. And so they got a camp they're doing and whatnot. And she ran out. And you know, before she got in her car, just came, and I put my hands on her head. I said, "May the Lord bless you, Victoria, keep you. May he cause you to be a leader and not a follower. And may he bring you back to me safe in Jesus' name." Nothing spooky. So you guys know Josh, right? The worship leader that's up here. That's my second oldest son. And Josh, man, I think Josh maybe might have saw me pray for Victoria before. And so then it was Josh's turn to leave, and he came and he did. He says, how old are you, 23, Josh? 22-year-old, Papa, bless me. You know, nothing weird. I just hug him, and I bless him. Are you understanding what I'm saying? I mean, so before the kids left, what if you just pray? Before we eat, before you take that phone call or before you walk into that appointment, what if you just, you get the picture? In everything, in every circumstance. I mean, before you put up that post on Facebook, y'all know what I'm talking about, right? As a matter of fact, some of you are praying for other people. You're thinking, "Man, I got to pray for them. They should have put that up, right?" I mean, but hey listen. Before you swipe that credit card, and all the men said, "Amen." right. So this is so important to us, right? This is so important to us. As a matter of fact, I want you to remember this, and it's so important. I got a little gift for you today. I'm going to give you a little gift to help remind you to pray first. Team, why don't you go ahead and come. Give these guys a little gift just to help them remind what they got to do. Amen? So I just got you a little wristband. And of course, if you haven't got one, just wave your hand. They'll get you one. Or maybe you can get one on the way out. They'll have those along with another little gift I got for you. But I gave you a little wristband, right? So this thing says, simply, say it with me, pray first. Listen, I want everybody to do this, right? Take that wristband, and I don't want you to face it outward. I want you to take those words, and I want you to speak to yourself. So you can read it, right? So every time you look at your watch, put on your watch hand. You guys with me? Every time you look at your watch, you're going to see the words that are going to remind you to, you see that? Huh? How would our life be different if in every circumstance, in every situation, we just prayed first? So here's the plan, right? So next Friday night, all summer we've been praying at 6:30. I want to extend an invitation to everybody here. Come and join us. Next Friday, 6:30, we start on time. I tried to say, you know, we're going to pray for 30 minutes. We couldn't. We prayed for an hour, right? But if you just come and join us. And so we'll join together. So we're going to pray together as a body. Then next Sunday, I'm going to give you part two of this two-part mini-series, Pray First. And then we're going to go into 21 days of prayer and feasting. We'll save the fasting for after the fat holidays. You know what I mean? But right now, it's summer. Somebody say, "I got to eat." You know what I mean? So, are you with me? So what we're going to do is we're going to go into 21 days of prayer and feasting. And so right here at 6 o'clock, we're going to come together every morning, 6 o'clock, Monday through Friday. We'll meet right here, and we're going to pray. Then on Saturday and Sunday, we'll meet here at 8:30. And we're gonna pray, say with me, first. Why prayer, right? Well, I have a scripture for you. So why pray? Because 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 through 18, God said this, right, through Timothy. Watch this. Read this with me now. Rejoice always. In other words, listen, prayer shouldn't be something that you dread, right? Rejoice always and what? Pray continually. Say that with me. Pray. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. This is God's will for you. And you know, so many people say, Pastor, I just want to know what the will of God is for my life. This is God's will. This is that we pray continually in every circumstance. Now listen, this doesn't mean that, you know, you go into solitary confinement, you know what I mean, and you go into a monastery where you never come out or you never speak to people, you only speak to God all the rest of your life. That's not what the text is saying here, right? Basically, when Paul says pray continually, he's simply saying this. Listen, prayer should be our first response and not our last resort. All he's saying. Prayer should be the first response and not the last resort. I mean, not act first and then pray for God to clean up our mess. No, listen. Before I take that phone call, I pray. Say it with me. Very good. I mean, simple, right? I mean, before I hit the send on that email, I pray first. That's simple. Now, think about how our nation would be different. I mean, how the world would be different if Christians all over the world simply prayed first. Can you think about that? I mean, just a couple of weeks ago, I mean, planes have fallen out the sky. I mean, commercial airlines are getting shot down with rockets and people are dying. You know what I mean? As a matter of fact, this is a little close to my heart because my son and my daughter-in-law are adopting a little girl from Hungary, and they're just, what, 60 kilometers or 50 kilometers from that crash site. Wow. All of a sudden, it becomes real. Can you imagine how the world might just be, I mean, right now in Israel, the conflict, right? I mean, people are dying in Gaza. I mean, and God said, I will bless those who bless Israel. Can you imagine with me how the world might be different if we just simply prayed first? You with me? No, look. As a matter of fact, 2 Chronicles chapter 7 says this. God said, when I shut up the heavens and there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people, if my people, say that with me, my people, who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. $17 trillion in debt as a nation, we need God to heal our finances in America, but we must pray first. You know what I think? I honestly gave this some thought, and I said, you know, God, why do we as Christians who profess, we love you with all of our heart, I mean, why don't God's people pray as much as we should, or we don't pray? And I believe that the reason why God's people don't pray, is it because they don't know that it's commanded in the Bible? Or I don't believe they do that because, you know, they don't know how important and how powerful prayer is. I believe that the reason why God's people don't pray is because they don't know how to pray. It's awkward. It's weird. They've never gotten to that vein of prayer. I mean, because the examples we have are either, you know, loud Pentecostals, you know, Jesus, or you know, the silent pious type, and it's like, well, that's just not, you know, it don't fit me, and you say, well, I can't pray like that, right? I just can't do it. So we get in prayer, and we're all over the place, right? And I don't know how to pray. And I'm here, and I'm there, and I'm rubbing my head. It seems to take forever. It reminds me of Boudreaux. Boudreaux got pulled over last week. Did you guys hear about that? It was in the paper. Oh, yeah, it was in the paper. Boudreaux got pulled over on Highway 90. He was all over the place. He was swerving all over the highway. The state trooper pulled him over, and he pulled him out of the car, and the state trooper said, Boudreaux, you're going to have to do a breathalyzer. Boudreaux said, man, I can't do that. The state trooper said, why? He said, because I'm asthmatic. So the state trooper said, well, then I guess we're going to have to do a blood test. And Boudreaux said, I can't do that. I'm a hemophiliac. Then the state trooper said, well, okay, then we have to do a urinalysis. To which Boudreaux responded, he said, no, I can't do that. I'm a diabetic. To which the state trooper told him, said, okay, Boudreaux, then you're going to have to walk this white line. Boudreaux said, I can't do that. I'm drunk. Yeah, some of you guys will pick up on that just a little bit later. And so when we pray, we're all over the place like Boudreaux, right? We're like drunk, we're all over the place. So my hope today is to kind of teach us how to pray. So if we're going to learn how to pray, let's go to the master, right? The one who, I mean, the master of all prayer. And Jesus, is being that master, taught us how to pray. As a matter of fact, in Luke chapter 11, verse 1, the Bible says, one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. And we're going to talk about that next week. We're going to talk about that certain place next week, right? And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray. Now stay with me. Listen to me. It wasn't that his disciples hadn't learned how to pray. These guys were from a very religious community. All the kids were taught how to pray. They all memorized prayers, right? All of them as children. It wasn't that they didn't know how to pray. But what the disciples were saying when they watched Jesus, they were saying, hey, I want to pray like that. Teach me to pray like that. There's power in the way that you're praying. Teach me to pray the way you pray, right? And so Jesus, in the Lord's Prayer, what we know as the Lord's Prayer, goes on and teaches a model for prayer. Now, this model was not meant so much to be memorized and recited. It was a model. It was an outline for prayer. And when Jesus teaches this model, he says, okay, there are seven areas that you might want to cover when you pray. When I pray, I cover these seven areas of prayer. Let's look at that prayer. You might know it. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 13. Jesus said, when you pray, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the what? Evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. That's the model of prayer. There are seven aspects to this prayer. Seven different areas that God says you're going to cover. So I'm going to give you those quickly this morning. Number one. Right? So what was Jesus saying? When Jesus taught us how to pray, he said, number one, when you enter into that prayer chamber with God and you begin to talk to God, begin by connecting with God relationally and not formally. Connect with God relationally, not formally. Listen to what Jesus said. When you pray, pray our Father in heaven. In other words, call him Father. You know, that's God's favorite name that he likes to be called by. Of all the names that the Bible talks about, right? God's, the name that God likes to be called by the most, his favorite name is Father. He said, so, and basically what he's trying to say is, I want you to engage, talk to me, connect with me relationally, not formally. You know, I just love my kids crawling on my lap. And of course, you know, my oldest daughter, she's married now. And the other day, I said, you know, my son-in-law, they were at the house on a Sunday. I just put her on my lap. I said, just come on. And she just come and cut her on my lap. I love that when all of them, when they were kids, I just love to snuggle. I love to touch, you know, and hug those guys. I mean, it's just, you know, because I'm their daddy. I just love it when they crawl up on my lap that way. You guys following me? I just love that thing. As a matter of fact, my favorite thing in the whole wide world to do, when my kids were young, I still love it, I just don't get it as much, but my favorite thing in the whole wide world to do is to go on a family walk. And when we go on family walks, my favorite thing is to hold hands. I just love it when I go on a family walk and I'm holding my little girl's hands or my little boy's hands and we're going on a family walk. I just love it so, so much. As a matter of fact, when my daughter got married in May, I walked her down the aisle and when it was all over, I came back home. She said, Papa, I have a present for you. And I said, what is it? And so she had a picture of me walking her down the aisle. Right? And so this is us, and that's the picture there. So I'm walking her down the aisle, but she framed a picture of she and I walking down the aisle. Now you can see on the frame right here, she wrote something. Let me tell you what she said. This is my favorite picture, right? Like I want to cry. I'm getting emotional right now. So Celeste gave me this picture, and she said, it says, out of all the walks we have taken, this one was my favorite. Wow. And so I get this, and I'm thinking, okay, whatever you want, you can have it. What do you want? You guys want to move in? You know, at that moment, she could ask me anything she wants. Yeah, I'm making sense, right? So Jesus says, listen, I want you to interact with God in that way. You know, the tough thing is not everybody had that relationship with their dad, and I got all that, but just know that God's favorite name to be called by is Father. And so the first thing we do is just sort of crawl up on his lap as children. In fact, the scripture says, you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Don't interact with me formally that way. But God goes on and he says this. He says, for you have received God's spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him what? Abba, Father. So Jesus taught us to pray. He said, first, connect with God relationally. Then Jesus goes on and he says, then the second thing you want to do is you want to worship, if you're taking notes, worship his name. What did Jesus say? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Worship his name. Hallowed means holy is the name of God. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelations, the Bible says that the angels surround the throne of God and day and night they cry out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come. Now listen, for us, man, what does that mean? Well, holy, that simply means that God, you're so good. I mean, you're not just good, you're the best. Father, you're the best. And you know what, not just you, you're not only the best, but Father, you're perfect. I mean, you're flawless. I mean, you're altogether separate. Nothing, no one can compare to you. You are in a league of your own. Holy. God, you're so awesome. As a matter of fact, most of the times when I'll begin to pray or I'll begin to worship, I'll go through the alphabet, like ABCs, and I'll use each letter of the alphabet just to describe God. I'll begin with A, like, oh, God, Father, you're so awesome. You're just so awesome. You're beautiful. How beautiful are you on the cross? And Lord, you're so courageous. I mean, you loved me when I was still your enemy. I mean, how much courage does that take? And I'll just go through all of the alphabet. God, you're so mighty and you're so powerful. And I'll just go through those different, you know, through the alphabet just like that. Right? God, you're awesome. Then sometimes, I mean, there are 16 different words in the Old Testament that God is named by. So there's 16 different names that are used for God in the Old Testament. Look, I just got eight. These are my eight of my favorite, right? And they all begin with like Jehovah, right? Meaning the Lord. And then there's a name that's attached to that. So God, Jehovah, Nisi. So I'll begin to tell God, Lord, you're my banner. In other words, meaning, God, you fight for me, right? You got my back. You're like my bro on my back. I mean, you're Jehovah Nissi. You're Jehovah Raha. In other words, you're my shepherd. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death today, I'm not going to be afraid. Your rod and your staff, they bring me comfort, right? I mean, you're going to smite the enemy before me, and you're going to keep me on the right track. You're my shepherd. Lord, you're Jehovah. You're a healer. God, you're my righteousness. You're my sanctifier. Lord, you're Jehovah Jireh. You're my provider. I'm not looking to the bank. I'm looking to heaven. I'm looking to you to provide. God, you're my peace, Jehovah Shalom. And here's my favorite. Here's my favorite one, Jehovah Shammah. If you don't know how to pray in tongues, that could be like, if you just say that fast over and over again, it might get you there. You know, Shammah, 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 Shammah. You know, I'm just kidding. Jehovah Shammah. In other words, the Lord is there. Wherever I go, I begin my day thinking, wherever I go today, God, you're going to be there. No matter where I'm at, God, you are there. David said it like this in Psalms 139, verse 8. David said, wherever I go, you are there. Where shall I go from your spirit? I mean, where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend up to the heights of heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths of Sheol, the grave, I mean, I could be buried in death, financial debt, 6 foot under, but God, you are there. I mean, I can rise on the wings of a bird, and I could go to the furthest ends of the earth. No matter where I go, you are, say it, there. I love that. God is always with me. No matter where I'm at, God, you're there. I'm never in this thing alone. And so I begin to pray, oh, Lord, I love you. You're my Father, right? And your name is great. This is who you are to me. And I remind myself, God, this is who you are to me. This is who you are, God. And then Jesus goes on, number three, and he says, and then pray God's agenda, his agenda first. So in other words, right, Jesus said, pray your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So basically, the next arena is to pray the will of God. Before you pray for your needs, be sure to pray that your will, God's will, be done. In other words, get your priority in straight. And so what's God's agenda? What's God's will? What's his kingdom agenda? It's others, man. It's always about others. And I'm telling you today, listen, I say this with all sincerity of heart, your life would be so much more complete and depression would flee from you if you'd stop thinking so much about you. I'm not trying to scold anybody. I'm just saying, because when I can think about me and my circumstances, then it can be overwhelming. I'm in trouble, you know, I mean, Lord. But as soon as I begin to pray God's agenda, God's will, and I start praying about others, what's God's agenda? Other people. God so loved the world. That's the world, the bigger world, right? And what's God's agenda? God's not willing that anybody would perish, but all would come to everlasting life. So I spend time praying the salvation of God to be released all over the earth, right? I pray for souls. I pray that God would strengthen the church. He said the harvest is ready. I mean, it's plentiful. It's ripe. But the laborers, you know, therefore, so I'll begin to pray for pastors and all churches all across America, that everybody sitting in pews don't just see themselves as sheep, you know what I mean? But they're world changers. I pray for you that way. I pray for you that way. God says, before you pray for your needs, pray your will be done on earth, God. As a matter of fact, Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 6, 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be given to you as well. That's the priority of life, right? Don't jump into what you need. Let's talk about God's will, right? As a matter of fact, I love the way the New Living Translation says it. Listen to this. He will give you all you need from day to day if you live for him and make the kingdom of God your primary concern. That's how we begin to pray. So we pray relationally, right? Then we worship his name. Then we pray his agenda. Then, number four, Jesus said, pray and depend on him for everything. Depend on God for everything. This is what Jesus said. Give us this day our daily bread. Listen, so only after you've prayed his will do you begin to pray for your needs, for our needs. And listen, I'm going to pray every day, right? I'm going to pray every day in every thing like I'm totally depending on God. Not just when I need him or it's above and beyond me. No, God, today, in every encounter I have, I'm praying today like I'm utterly dependent upon you for everything today, right? So then we pray, right? We pray, God, give us our daily bread. And this is why we say it with me, pray first. I pray before I leave because I depend on God for everything, right? As a matter of fact, Psalms 122 said this, I look up to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the one who made the heaven and the earth. Listen, mountains signify government, okay? And government, look, I'm not looking to Capitol Hill to solve my problems. I'm looking to a much higher court than that. And that's how I begin. I'm not dependent upon no one else, nothing but you, God. Then number five, Jesus said, then get your heart right with God and with people. Don't leave that prayer appointment with God without getting your heart totally right with him and with people. Jesus said it like this. He said, pray, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So the first thing I want to pray, almost every time I pray, is here's my prayer, and it should be your prayer. Lord, I'm asking you today, please, God today, don't let me become desensitized to sin. Don't let me look at sin and think, well, that's just life and it's natural. I want to be kept, you know what I mean? I want to be kept right with you. And so I'll pray Psalms 139, verse 23. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Test me. Know my anxious thoughts and see if there's any offensive way in me. Is there something in me? I mean, a hidden blind spot in my life that offends? And this is usually when I spend my time reading the Word of God. I'm reading because I'm looking for a command to obey. I'm looking for you to speak to me. Search me, know me. So I pause in prayer. And I take a moment to do business with God and let God do business with me. God, convict me today. Convict me if you see me going astray, right? Then after I pray that, then I'm going to go through the list of others whom, you know, I might be just struggling with. Like maybe they've hurt me or they have this propensity to hurt me. I'm in ministry. It happens a lot. You know what I mean? So, or disappoint me or what? Listen, so I make a decision before I ever leave out of prayer that day, I'm going to walk in forgiveness. I'm not going to let bitterness rule over my life because I'm going to forgive, because this is God's law, right? Forgive me my debt as I forgive those. I don't forgive those and you know, I just make sure that I take care of that business. So after I pray, right, after I get my heart with God, then number six, I engage in spiritual warfare. Say that with me, spiritual warfare. Can I get the worship team to come, please? Jesus said this, do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Here is the accurate translation. So God doesn't lead anybody into temptation. You guys know that? As a matter of fact, James addressed this in the letter that he wrote. And he said, don't let any man say when he's tempted that God's the one that's leading him to be tempted. He said, don't do that. I'm not going to lead you into temptation. But we all got this nature on the inside of us. It's a lean to sin. It's a sin nature. So basically, the accurate translation would simply be, look, Father, don't allow me to be led into temptation. In other words, I know today I'm going to have an opportunity to sin. God, can you just please help me stay out of it? I know I'm gonna have an opportunity. Can you just help me avoid that track? Listen, this is spiritual warfare 101. Every day, engage in spiritual warfare, right? As a matter of fact, the scripture says this, not just for me, but I do so for my family. Nehemiah chapter 4, the Bible says, fight for your families. Pray and fight for your families. And this is where we fight and confront the enemy of our family. So I'll pray for my children right there for the beginning at the beginning of the day. Why? Because there's a real war taking place. Ephesians chapter 6, God said this, verse 12, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers and against authorities and against powers of this dark world, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. So I'm going to engage in spiritual warfare. And then finally, Jesus said, here's the seventh arena, right? This is how you go close this thing out. When it's all over, after you've done fighting the devil and said, God, keep me and all that stuff. And then he says, number seven, express faith in God's ability. Real simple. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. In other words, right, basically, you just tell God, God, I know you got this. Everything we talked about today, I know you got this at hand. As a matter of fact, Jeremiah said it like this. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 17. Ah, sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth, and by your great power and your outstretched arm, nothing is too hard for you. Come on, say it with me. Nothing is too hard for you. And so I remind myself, and I tell God, God, there's nothing too hard for you. Revelation chapter 5, verse 13. Stay with me. Come on, stay with me right now. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. And all of the people said, amen. Amen, everybody. Come on now. Amen. That's how we close in prayer. Every head bowed. Father, I pray for this church today. Heavenly Father, I'm asking you, God, inspire us and teach us to be a people of prayer. That instead of acting first, we pray first in every situation, every circumstance. God, I'm praying over the next 21, 30 days, Father, in the name of Jesus, in this next season, birth a full of prayer in this congregation. Help us to draw closer to you, to know you in prayer. I'm asking you, Father, the first area of prayer, our Father, connecting with God relationally. Here's the deal. Jesus came to destroy that barrier between you and God. My question to you today is, you're bowed in prayer. My question is simply this. Does God seem distant to you? You seem disconnected? Listen, God's made a way. I want you to pray today. It's a prayer of just surrendering your life to him. And if everything in you right now is screaming, it's screaming, I want to be closer to God. I want to be close to God. If everything in you wants to be close to God right now, I'm going to help you with a prayer today that's going to draw you closer to God. Just pray this with me. You can pray this in the quietness of your heart. You can whisper it under your breath. Just pray this. If that's you, just pray this with me right now. Say, dear Jesus, I thank you for destroying that barrier between me and the Father. I thank you that you've chosen to forgive me, that your blood washes me and makes me clean so I can come into the presence of the Father and not be all dirty and smelly. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Jesus, today I believe that you are my Savior. And so I ask you to save me. I ask you to come into my heart. Jesus, be the Lord of my life and save me from all the sin that's destroying my life. In your precious name I pray. Amen, amen, amen. Why don't you give God some love, everybody? Amen, amen. Amen. So, say, listen to me, listen. If you just prayed that prayer with me, I want to encourage you today, take a next step. Let me know that you've done that, right? So before you leave today, right, Remember that Connect and Grow card? Just take a moment, fill that thing out, and go to that little box that says decision, and just indicate the decision that you made today. And when we take up the offering and the offering comes before you, just drop that in the bucket, and that card will make its way to my desk. My wife and I will pray for you. Our intercessory prayer team, they're going to be praying for you, and we won't. Listen, nothing spooky. We're not going to, like, bum rush your house, you know what I mean, with, like, you know, the bread ministry, you know what I mean, like knocking on your door. Hey, we brought you bread. No, it's nothing like that, right? I mean, we this is a no-hassle policy. We're not going to hassle you or anything like that. But I'd just love to be able to know that you prayed that prayer, and so we can begin to provide at least some sort of prayer covering for your life. Amen? Well, as the ushers make their way forward and you prepare your heart to give this morning, I want to share one quick passage of scripture. It's found in Psalms 84, verse 11. This is the New Living Translation. And the Bible says, "For the Lord God is our sun and our shield. He gives us grace and glory." Watch this. "The Lord will withhold no good thing from those who do what is right." Amen. Amen. Listen, if you're a guest here today, this part of the service isn't for you, right? This is part of the family. This is what we do. We give. And if you're still searching, stuff like that, now you're welcome to give, but don't feel any pressure or anything like that. That's not for you. Amen. If you want to give, of course, you can do it through Secure Give, our phone app, or you can give online, hopealive.com, stuff like that. And anyways, that's all that. Amen. Why don't you guys stand to your feet, and we're going to lift up our offering before the Lord. Let me bless that thing. And listen, we're not dismissing. Somebody say, this is not a dismissal. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, don't run for the door. It's not a dismissal. All right, we're gonna bless this offering, and then we're going to worship with the team, a chorus or something like that. And then we'll come back, and I'll give you some final instructions, and we'll dismiss. Amen? Amen. Well, Father, in the name of Jesus, I bless every gift, God, every giver today, knowing that we have this confidence. You will not withhold any good thing that we ask of you if we're right with you. Lord, we know that this offering doesn't make us right with you, but it was the offering of your son Jesus. And it's because of that offering, God, we just want to give the first portion. Just as we made a decision to pray first, we want to give the first portion, that tenth portion of our increase, of our income, to tell you, God, that we know that this money belongs to you. Lord, bless the giver. Bless the gift. Help us to reach more people in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on, how many guys appreciate the word of God this morning? Amen. Amen. Listen, before I dismiss you this morning, right, a couple of things. If you need prayer, there's some wonderful prayer counselors. They're going to be standing right here. They're coming right now. They're standing up here. And if you have any prayer requests, man, they are the guys that you grab a hold of their hands. They say, look, we're going to pray with you. We're going to pray heaven down with you, believing that God's going to meet your every need. Amen? As a matter of fact, I think we are prepared. I don't know who's in that corner. I think it's Tom and Ole Martinson. They'll be serving communion. So if you're someone this morning that wants to participate in communion, you want to pull up a seat at the Lord's table, as soon as the worship is over, then Tom and Ole, they're going to bless communion. They'll give you some instructions, and you guys can, take communion right there on that side of the building. Amen? Amen. Amen. Why don't you guys lift up your hands before the Lord? I'm going to bless you and dismiss you. I bless you today with this simple prayer that may the grace, amazing grace of Jesus, the extravagant love of the Father, and the intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit be yours always in every circumstance as you leave this place, making this decision today that you choose to pray first in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Here we go.
Pastor Bobby would love to have the opportunity to pray for you and your family. If you would like more information about the ministries of Hope Alive Freedom Church, check out our website at www.hopealive.com. And thanks again for tuning in.